What was the scene going on here, Robbie? What were you going to say?
I think the next question I ask her is regarding this very thing.
Oh, okay. I rewound it like 6 seconds. Here we go.
If you, not for the court, we would not pay for that. Well, I'm not asking you to pay for it. I'm simply asking if I have the right to choose anybody that I want as assistant.
If they are a licensed attorney with an Oregon State Bar member, they may serve as your counsel.
Oh my God. Oregon State bar number, but oh no, it's separate from the plaintiff, the state of Oregon.
If they're licensed with a bar member.
God.
It's like, oh my God, can we not have this conversation? You know?
It's remarkable how dumb.
It's like my question is if not. Oh. See, she's saying if, but she's implying only if.
Yeah.
Right? At least tell me. It's like, no. Not get counsel of your choosing.
If it's
you'll get check counsel of your sub choosing.
Yeah, don't do it. Yep. I'm just gonna
we get counsel
it.
Of our choosing. You can choose from among them.
All right, here we go.
Whatever that may be, so it sounds to me as though I'd be applying the right to assistance of counsel that is not licensed by the plaintiff. I'm not my disparate counsel.
I'm not gonna answer that. Is that what she said?
That is your opinion. Yes.
And that's just your opinion. Yes.
So you reviewed. I handed it to you this document called waiver of counsel, and I see that you reviewed it on an initial credit call for your initials, and that you signed it. Did you understand everything in this paperwork? I'm not asking you to agree with it, but did you understand it?
Oh my God.
Oh crap. See again, she's understand it.
Yeah. Not if you agree with it, if you understand it. You're binding yourself. I mean, not you, Robert,
yes.
But one person is binding themselves by signing those things. You have
yep.
to agree.
Now, there is no that concept that she's saying you don't agree with something you signed doesn't exist.
It's like saying you don't agree to go to jail, but you're signing that you're gonna go to jail. But you don't agree with it. What the fuck?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, and she has to say that because of this threat of violence, right?
Yeah.
She's needing to tap dance
yeah.
around the concept of agreement.
The art of hiding violence. How to be a judge 101.
The art of hiding violence, yes.
And I have to say that at this point, I think I make a bit of a mistake because I was still afraid of contempt. So I'm not exactly proud of how I respond.
I don't get it.
Oh, you'll hear.
Well, I don't care if you signed papers so that you don't have to go to jail, Robbie.
No, it's a response to one of her questions.
Oh, cool. Okay, here we go.
Well, you indicated that I signed it. Right. So, but I'm just checking to make sure that you understood what you read. Some
well,
people don't read things; they just sign things. So, with all due respect, I don't want to.
There's nothing to indicate to me that you are in any mental infirmity today, so I believe you'd be competent to make this decision. I have an obligation to let you know what you're charged with, and so...
You know, there's this universal human trait that I, you know, was trained into me about public speaking and human psychology and lie detecting and deception. And it's this incessant verbal pausing to constantly be thinking about navigating the sentence structure. I mean, this is what a judge does. They do it all the time. This should be flowing out of their face, but they're always, she's, she knows that she's got to get some way to get on the record here that this is voluntary and that he is not being coerced. That she's tap dancing and she knows, oh God, how am I going to do this? The stuttering is just really telling. That's all I'm saying. It's a joke.
Yep.
What you are charged with is count one, interfering with a peace parole or probation officer, which alleges that on or about February 28, 2016, in the state of Oregon, that Robert Earl Estabrook did unlawfully and intentionally refuse to obey a lawful order by a person nullified to be a peace officer contrary to Oregon law. And count two, charge of criminal trespass in the second degree, which alleges that on or about February 28, 2016, in the county of Multnomah, state of Oregon, that Robert Estabrook did unlawfully, intentionally.
Now keep in mind, this happened back in February, and she's finding it necessary to read you charges.
That's interesting. That is a good point.
Why?
She's trying to arrest.
And you know, you notice how part of it is known by you to be an officer of the law, though. She said something like that.
Yeah, no, like known by me to be a lawful order. Like, what the hell? Like, even on the arrest video, it's what authority are you? You know.
Yeah, I happen to be Port Authority. But, and here's the thing, we're already, the date of this hearing was 6 months past February 28th, and they're reading you charges. So much for a speedy trial again.
Yeah, it's wow, I still don't know who to be an officer of the law. That's what I'm trying to show, you know, I'm trying to ask for is evidence of applicability.
Evidence of applicability.
So it's almost like they can't give it to you in a sense, because then they will have confess that you didn't know it until then.
Right.
Sometimes it strikes me that if they say, here's the evidence of applicability, they almost have to maintain that you know already.
Yep.
Oh, yeah. That's hilarious, too. They give you 15 minutes, sign this, and then do you understand it all? Like, oh, I don't have day of law school, and I'm asking for the assistance.
They need to get the lies more overt than just an autograph, right?
Right.
They want it in writing, in verbal.
That's just a point there that I think would be convincing with the public. It's just that here's a judge, obviously showing bias to the prosecutor. It's written all over this recording, and she's forcing more lies, more of this threat and everything on the record. And meanwhile, I lost it. It poofed out of my head. Embarrassing, it happens.
Oh, man.
Dang it. Now it's going to bother me. It'll pop back in there in a minute, and I'll be like, ah, screw it. Oh, well, here it goes.
Unlawfully and intentionally, knowingly, or recklessly remain in the pond. The premises located at Portland International Airport screening area, contrary to state law. The first count one, interfering with a peace officer, is a Class A misdemeanor. It carries a maximum sentence of 1 year in jail and $6,250 in fine.
Or, if you'll sign this paper, 8 hours of community service. Ta-da!
Yeah, I'm going to please explain to me what you mean by $6,250.
No recording.
What's going on here?
So she sees somebody who lifts up his cell phone and he starts actually video recording at this point.
Okay.
No,
I'm not.
Okay, well, holding your cell phone up.
All right.
Oh, so just holding a device that's off, up, can get you thrown in jail in a courtroom? Because you could just say, no, it's off. Clearly it's off. I'm going to hold it up anyway as a matter of civil protest. It's a symbol. This is a public hearing, right? I'm holding it up.
Yeah, and notice.
Go ahead.
Oh, well, I just asked her to clarify what she meant by a $6,250 fine.
Yeah.
And she sort of uses this as a way to ignore the question.
Yeah, yeah. I've got my ears on that.
And then count two, criminal trespass to 7-3. Is a Class C misdemeanor that carries a maximum sentence of 30 days in jail and $2,500 in fines.
Okay, point of clarification. presentation, can you please clarify for me what you mean by those numbers and the fines?
Yeah, that's the absolute maximum jail time that you ever get.
I'm not asking specifically about the jail fines.
That's the maximum fine. The maximum fine you can get any court could ever impose on you. I'm not saying this is what will happen, just for the maximum amount of law.
But I mean, what do you?
She just said that's the maximum fine any court could impose upon you. Question, point of clarification, will they require evidence of jurisdiction before such an imposition?
and the point at hand is, she's not explaining what physically she'll be ordered to do.
Oh, of course.
What does it mean? What physical, reality-based thing is someone ordered to do when they're ordered to submit $50 or whatever it was, mm-hmm. right? And what does that mean? It's like, okay, I will go get 50 rocks, but 50, and the point, of course, is they're actually implying without stating that you're supposed to get the cooperation of a bank
yeah.
to get 50 of these Federal Reserve notes kind of
yeah.
going.
Yeah.
But they don't want to say, because they ordering you to do something that involves a third party is one of those no-nos, right?
Yeah.
Ordering you to go get your sister's retainer, right, or hair clip, or whatever, would be an unjust sentence because it involves the cooperation of a third party for you to complete. Ordering $50 be paid does the same. It is just as troublesome, but they do it so routinely, you know, and they need to because that's, you know, if they told you to give them something you had on you or they knew you owned, that'd be different.
Right, but for them to force you to try and participate in a particular system of currency under threat of jail, you can challenge that. You don't just have to be like, fine.
But you can only challenge it. Sorry, but you can only challenge it if they've actually been clear.
Good luck getting them to be clear.
Yeah, and this is just another one of those things where I point out where I'm not allowed to be informed of the cause and nature of the proceedings. So,
gotcha.
Kind of fun point.
Yeah.
What do you mean by the court imposing a fine?
If you were convicted, the court would have authority to impose a fine. The most expensive fine the court would impose would be $6,250 on count one and $1,000 on count two.
One clarification, can you please explain to me what you mean by $6,250 and $12,000 fines?
$6,250 is the amount of fines.
So I'm
can you not understand that number?
It's
obviously that's an insult and a dig to try and make you look silly and
the number isn't a question.
Right.
She knows that.
Yep.
It's not the number that I do not understand. I don't understand what that means and what you're asking for specifically.
It's $6,250.
And
it can only be imposed if you were found guilty.
And how are you expecting me to you need to find what you mean by dollar and what it is that I'm supposed to be giving you?
I'm not going to answer that question.
So you're not going to
order dollars.
You're not going to clarify this for me because I'm wondering what you're asking for if you're asking for
nothing more $100.
So you're not going to let me get informed and answer relevant clarifications.
That is the maximum penalty that you face.
This you're tapping against the extent of the judge's knowledge. She wants nothing to do with stepping into what is a U.S. dollar and why.
She damn well knows that you are asking about it.
Oh, yeah.
Right? She's just saying, I'm not going to clarify that.
That's right. But you're going to be...
And the funny thing is, find someone who understands that word.
Yeah, good.
She's acting as if it's common knowledge, like how, you know, incredulity. Like, how could someone not know what I'm meaning? No, I'm asking you to specify. We're in a formal setting where you're going to order me to do something specific. At least do so specifically as what you're intending me to do.
Under threat of giving men with guns permission to take my freedom from me, no matter what it costs. while that open thread is out there until I get this done. So it's slightly important to clarify.
On the record that the judge is non-responsive and she's not informing the
I know that you have been in communication with Ms. Plank.
Now she reaches out to the prosecutor to try and save her.
And that you guys have discussed discovery, is that accurate?
I think we spread it out.
Here comes the prosecutor right on cue to try and diverge right down another path they want to go down.
Discovery. I have discussed both the options that have extended in this case.
I'm wondering if you need more of the prosecutor to burden a proof that to see if she has submitted any evidence establishing jurisdiction for the court to impose upon you?
Well, they have an obligation under law to give you discovery.
Dodge. It's like, we didn't talk about that obligation. We're talking about a different obligation.
The evidence that this is effective is written also in their silence, their repeated inability to anywhere close to answer that meat and potatoes issue. If this all was full of shit, they'd be able to answer that. They'd be able to answer it in some way that satisfied everybody, including the public.
Or they would officially say, there is no evidence, and we don't care.
Right. I even actually have them recorded saying that here later. There is no evidence. The state doesn't have to provide evidence. The state never provides evidence prior to the entry of a plea.
And then I bet you they didn't say that there is none. I bet you they carefully left that part out. They probably did say that the court doesn't have to, or they said there isn't any in the record or something like that.
Well, she said they don't.
But saying that there is no evidence.
They don't present it.
Really?
Well, you can hear it. It's at the beginning of the last video I posted. I put it right at the beginning of the video for the first few seconds.
There's a difference between there's no evidence presented and there's no evidence in existence.
Sure. So she was just saying, until a plea is entered, the state doesn't have to and never does present any evidence.
That is not the question at hand, though, right?
That's
I'm not
saying that's this one. I'm saying that's later. Different situation. Okay.
Oh, I gotcha.
But yeah, and then right after that, she says, I will not accept your plea unless you give up all of your rights. So you put those two things in conjunction, and it's like, oh dear God. All right, here we go.
Have you received discovery of the case?
I believe that I received some paperwork from the alleged prosecutor, and I have not yet found any factual
evidence establishing
jurisdiction, so I'm wondering if there is any
that is being
helpful,
if you're
aware of any evidence.
I don't have access to their court files. Are there files they use when they prosecute?
She's just stating an obvious fact that has nothing to do with what you said again.
You can file a motion to compel discovery. You wouldn't have that right to do so, and we would schedule a hearing on that motion to compel discovery if you chose to do that.
Have you read the motion that I have submitted?
Not yet, because I need to clarify. I can't communicate with you if you're represented by a lawyer. I can communicate with a lawyer, so I need to clarify whether you represented yourself or are.
So, smell the bullshit in that. You're not yet represented by a lawyer, so she should be able to communicate with you just fine by her own words. She can look on the record and see if there is an attorney attached to the case or not. She believes the computer every other time she looks at it, but this time she has to verify what the computer says? Go fuck yourself. That is ridiculous.
Wait a minute. She is actually feigning ignorance about whether he has an attorney or not at this point?
Yeah. She said she didn't read the motion to dismiss. She came unprepared or read it and is saying she didn't read it. But she's saying she didn't read it because she wouldn't be able to communicate with him because she didn't know if he had a lawyer or not. So she had to come here and find out. Oh, it's the weakest excuse. It's such BS.
Yeah, so she's trying to use one of the two ways for me to submit to the court's jurisdiction, so that she can rule against the motion and say, well, there is evidence of jurisdiction because you have done A or B.
Yeah.
Right?
That was included in
there's that. Evidence.
Yeah, you look up the evidence of that.
Once I get A and B, then we'll address the motion.
Lawyers. having indicated that you understood everything that you reviewed, even though you don't agree with it. And the court.
How can you sign something and then they know you don't agree with it? So you're signing something that says, I clearly understand or acknowledge this, but she acknowledges that you don't agree with what you signed. So you acknowledge it, but you signed it, but you don't agree with it. Yeah, because I'm under duress, like I've said a million times already, and you are refusing to not only acknowledge that, you're forcing me to claim fraudulently that I'm not under duress. So in order to keep me out of a cage. Your words, not mine. This lady, man. Woo! She's clumsy. This is particularly clumsy. Too funny.
Finding that I have explained elements of the crime and maximum penalties.
Whoa, she just said she's explained the elements of the crime and the maximum penalties. She just slipped that in there. Oh yeah, I've explained the elements of the crime. Really, I've been screaming about one particular element of this quote-unquote crime the whole time, and you have yet to clarify anything about it. You refuse to, other than to threaten me with a jail cell for doing so.
And she hasn't even explained the maximum penalties. She distinctly said, I'm not going to clarify that.
Yeah, that too. You said you wouldn't clarify anything about the dollars. I must go find these dollars so that you won't send me to a jail cell further in the future. I mean, it's just all over the place. This is... Impressive ineptitude.
They don't explain to me what the X star line actually means.
But he just brought it up.
I'm not sure what you're saying.
Not finding that to be a plausible question.
Plausible correction?
Plausible question.
Oh. Not finding that to be a plausible question. I see.
I'm not finding that to be a plausible question. What was the question?
You didn't clarify what these dollars were. Objection, point of clarification. What if I was from Russia and didn't speak any English and wasn't familiar with using dollars at all? What if I just used Russian currencies?
It's profound. She has a point in that your hypothetical includes something that's clearly not true.
Oi. I missed the first part of that.
She has a point.
Yeah.
As dishonest as she's being, because you're using an analogy to, you're exaggerating to make point. And then she's saying it's not a plausible question. Well, yeah, it's not supposed to be. It's an exaggeration to prove a point, right?
Well,
it isn't a plausible question.
It's
an exaggerated question.
Yeah, I didn't bring up that example. I simply let her know that she hadn't even clarified to me what the fines meant or what a dollar was.
What was the question that wasn't plausible? Oh, the dollar question wasn't plausible.
Right.
Right.
Like she didn't know how to make it plausible to plausible that question.
Whatever that is.
And you made yourself quite available for clarification. You just didn't want to have it.
Right.
Right?
This is what I'm doing. Go ahead, Ronnie.
I was just agreeing.
Oh, gotcha.
You know, you can't say I didn't understand the question when you're there saying I'm happy to explain.
I'm simply asking what you would be asking for me if you impose a fine upon me.
I'm pretty confident, Mr. Essenberg, that you understand the concept of a court penalty and dollars. I'm pretty sure you have an
objection.
She's pretty sure, she's presuming that you understand the concept of a dollar.
Not without certainty.
I would file a motion of your understanding of a dollar and confirm it at this point, because she is proceeding upon her presumption that you understand it.
So just file a motion and define a dollar, however I might need to.
Well, I mean, no, it's oddly enough, a dollar isn't that well defined.
It's like
so a dollar is either a bunch of silver or a note that is intended to represent that.
Like
you don't say that the Federal Reserve has to make it. You can make your own.
If she said $100 of silver,
it'd be pretty clear what you owed.
Yep.
of course, $100 of silver would be extreme, and they don't request that. Again, she's presuming that you're going to draw the Fed into it. Why would you draw the Federal Reserve into it? A dollar, Australian dollars don't have any relationship to the Fed. Canadian dollars don't have any relationship to the Fed.
That's just a private bank. What the hell do they have anything to do with any of this here? Oh, that's right. There's a monopoly on power.
Yes, and when the courts are talking about dollars, it is implied that they mean Federal Reserve, but they never want to say it.
Yep, they can't. It exposes the
more. There's a problem. If they say it, then you can start asking about, are you compelling me to do business with a third party? Yep.
And she knows, which is why she's refusing to engage in the relevant issue on the table right now.
Mm-hmm.
Comes back with, do you not understand the number? Duh. Yeah, that's on the table right now. Duh, right back at you.
And we know exactly what she means.
Yeah.
The problem is that everybody knows exactly what's meant.
Yeah.
She is being coy about bringing in the topic of the Federal Reserve. She is very deliberately not talking about what it is.
And this kind of
that's like saying, you know. Like, no, you can't say, you know, what am I accused of? You know. No, you need to state your case.
She didn't even get that far. She was like, I'm pretty sure. I'm like, you're not even saying this with any certainty. You're pretty sure? And you're just going to go on that. Oh, okay.
Jail. What is jail? And I have a conception of what jail is that I'm pretty sure is wrong.
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure my conception of jail is very inaccurate, or it might randomly be accurate for some jails.
Yeah.
The problem is, I don't know how much anal rape is involved. I don't know. I mean, there's a lot of things I don't know about jail.
Yep. Countless. I mean, and
other than a little county jail up the street.
And for anybody who's listening, this sounds like a crazy exception. Obviously, you're new to the channel, but this is the type of thing that you'll find anywhere. In any county, in any state, all over the place. And it happens because we don't go in there and struggle, and we pay their fines. We pay for this to continue in the future. And all it would take is just this slight struggle and not paying, and then this goes away. I mean, easier said than done.
I mean, if they fail to argue with you about what a dollar is, and you make up your own, you make Robbie dollars, right? Right? And those are dollars. I mean, by any
monopoly,
by the same standards that they choose to make Federal Reserve notes as dollars. Because they can't be redeemed for anything but other notes. And you make up 2 cents. And they can be redeemed for the other set if you want. Anytime. You've met everything that the Federal Reserve notes on.
It's nuts.
Now, if they're saying that they're wanting things that the IRS will accept as dollars or something like that, then they need to bring those people in to tell you what, you know, what your punishment is.
Yep.
But they're avoiding the conversation. They're avoiding the topic like the plague.
Big time.
I'm asking for a relevant clarification on the record of what you are trying to impose when you were. I'm not trying to go into it right now, because I know the point of those, but you're not clarifying what that means, and I have no idea what you mean by a $1,000 fine, for example. I have no idea what you're asking for on the record. I'm not asking for any fine, but I'm letting you know that the court, if you were found guilty, with all the rights to the trial, right? So you have a right at trial to have a jury.
Just starts going off into rights that you have for a trial, which isn't on the table, you didn't ask for, and does nobody any good, and it's so blatantly obvious it's just a stalling tactic, number 47.
Yep.
We don't no do other. It, and they do. I don't know what... It's just so obvious, I guess. I'll get over it.
In the evidence, there'd be six people. You have the right to have the district attorney.
She just said six people.
All the witnesses to trial to prove your guilt beyond a reasonable doubt. You have a right to have that process occur. The state would be obligated to call witnesses and examine those witnesses and maybe under oath, and their testimony would be introduced into the record. You have the right to cross examine those witnesses.
You have the right to call witnesses of your own. You have the right to compulsory process under Constitution, so you have the right to issue a subpoena to get witnesses to appear.
Objection, point of clarification. This Constitution that you're talking about, is there any evidence that it actually applies to me in the statutes and codes that you've made under it? I mean, would break it open, wide open right there on the Constitution itself and maybe get down our path a little bit, but probably not, obviously.
Why is the Constitution relevant?
Yeah. So you've sworn an oath to this document. I haven't. You're imposing it upon me absent any evidence whatsoever and claiming I have to pay dollars that has to do with a federal private bank on the side. Is that what's going on here, yes or no? Really, sometimes just describing the bullshit and then say, is that what's happening, yes or no? I mean, it allows you to put all the bullshit on the record and just make it a clarification at the end.
On your behalf,
do I have the right to prepare a meeting?
Well, we're talking about a meeting right now. You've asked me, to explain to you the question that you asked about fines.
Well, I know you just asked that one, but I'm going to go ask the one that you asked before, finally. Oh, that one you never did before? But you're going to claim to here? Okay.
To explain to you the process of how that works. And so after all that process, after closing arguments, the evidence would be submitted to the jury for their consideration. If the jury found you guilty after deliberations, then would come time for sentencing. So that would come time for the judge to say, what penalty should I impose now that you're found guilty? The worst thing that the judge could ever do would be, as I indicated, up to 1 year in jail.
Or sign this, bend your knee, shut up, obey, and it'll be 8 hours of community service. Insane.
Yeah.
It's so insane that this is real.
On the class A misdemeanor, 30 days on the class C, and then the worst thing that the judge could do is $6,250 in fines. And then you would be obligated to pay those fines.
Can you please explain to me how it is that I can, quote, pay those fines? Because I'm not sure what you're asking specifically.
I don't know how you can pay those fines because I don't know anything about your own personal circumstances.
What does my personal circumstances have anything to do with a claim that I need to pay dollars by you in X amount?
Has to.
One has
like, what am I being expected to deliver to you? What right. Physically are you describing? What physical action are you saying I will be punished for?
Yep.
That's understandable.
Sorry. No, what's that? I just, you're...
Bring us a bucket of sand or water, and that can be understood.
Your microphone, the way it's coming in, Gary, it's like either great or muffled, and it's going in between great and muffled.
Oh, sorry.
I don't know why. Well, you know, sorry. I don't know if that's just Skype doing it or what.
I'm leaning over and covering my mic. Sorry about that.
Oh, okay. That's way better. Okay. Here we go.
The right to present those to the judge at the time of sentencing and having them take those into consideration. So I have accepted your waiver of counsel.
Under clarification, still, I'm asking if I were. Imposed with $1,000 fine, what is it specifically that the court is going to want at that time?
We're not there yet. You said you had a motion that you wanted.
Well, I'm attempting to be informed of the cause and nature of these accusations that you're indicating these as.
I've explained it sufficiently,
but I object.
And I'm finding that you're being obstinate and I'm going to object to the
record. Obstinate? She's putting that on the record.
Are you saying that me asking for relevant clarification is being obstinate?
I've explained it 4 or 5 times, and I'm confident that you understand the concept of what I'm talking about.
So you're assuming that I understand what a fine is?
Yes, because I understand the intent.
How is it?
I don't know what the answer is. Do you have a motion?
Do I have the choice of just not answering questions that get posed to me as well, or is equality something that is just wholly absent from this courtroom, whether you're pretending it exists or not? I don't know. Like, I just love that. You not only have to answer their questions, you have to lie and bind yourself on documents under threat of a jail cell, but they don't even have to answer your question when it's relevant.
About the document, the, a recording of your design.
Oh, yeah. About said document, yeah.
You wanted the file?
Yeah, I would move it to recuse yourself.
I'm not going to write it. I'm not going to grant that motion. I'm not signing it.
On what grounds?
As to that?
On what grounds are you defining that motion? I have a relevant reason why you should recuse yourself.
What is the reason why you feel I should recuse myself?
The reason you should recuse yourself is because you're showing bias. You've already threatened me on the record with contempt. I cannot make a decision. You're forcing me to make a decision when all of my own intention is to enter a guilty plea and accept the deal from this attorney.
You were free to do so, but I had to. I did not take a guilty plea from someone who has either not agreed to represent himself or have an attorney represent himself.
So they won't let you take the deal until.
Bullshit.
Yeah.
Bullshit.
Yep, until you represent yourself or get another attorney signed on. Both are shit.
Simply asking before I make that decision, has the prosecutor submitted any evidence that the court has jurisdiction to impose upon? And you are not only urging for urging proof.
Well, right now we're not having a trial. Right now we're having an administrative hearing to determine what.
An administrative hearing. Is this some slick way that this still isn't a regular courtroom? I mean, what the hell? This is what they call any nonsense. They can't. They call it that because they can't call it arraignment tent number 7. Is it administrative hearing? Okay.
Is the next step in your case?
I am not asking for a trial. I'm challenging jurisdiction at this time. So I ask, has the prosecutor submitted any evidence or has jurisdiction to impose upon me? You are not answering.
Well, all the information I have is that you've been arraigned and that you had an opportunity to have discovery or information in the court system. That's sufficient for me to have authority to proceed as the judge in your case. I was planning to want to respond to that.
So you are.
Well, prosecutor, please rescue me. Does the prosecutor want to respond to that?
Yeah, because she hears me about to object and speak, and she's like, oh, prosecutor, please speak.
Prosecutor, please speak. Here we go.
At the last hearing, Judge Roberts, I believe you informed Mr. Essenberg about the only way in which he can challenge or require the state prosecutor's office to prove jurisdiction, a subject matter or personal, is to, in fact, request a trial.
No kidding.
Hold on right here. Let's see the dodge. Okay. So that is true and misleading.
Right.
It is absolutely true. The only way to probe at the evidence and to ask for you to prove it, but that's not what you asked for. You asked if there's any evidence that is submitted to the court as of now. They could just say no. That's all they'd have to say is, none has been submitted. We don't know if it exists. It might exist. We presume it exists. Whatever they'd say. But all they have to say to answer your question is no.
There's no.
And now they're misconstruing it to mean, you know, you can you're demanding that they prove it.
Right.
No, you're just wanting information about what they have submitted to the court. It's not even about what they have in their rubby hands yet. We haven't even gotten that far.
Yeah.
Your question so far is merely, has the prosecutor given the court any? And they won't answer that baby step of a question. It's not, does any exist in the universe? It's not, does he have any in his file? It's not, has he done any work? It is merely, has any been given to the court, which supposedly you're supposed to be included on. Anything that's submitted to the court, you're supposed to get a copy of. You're asking for something that you're supposed to have a copy of, and they won't answer it.
Right. And I wonder if we could, just for the sake of effectiveness through their bullshit minefield, if it might be helpful to go from, has a prosecutor submitted evidence establishing jurisdiction, to has a prosecutor submitted evidence that pertains to jurisdiction or to the element of jurisdiction, because they seem to be getting hung up on this
establishing. That would be easy because evidence pertaining to jurisdiction, pertaining to certain aspects of venue and standing, not that show it by any stretch of the imagination, right? But that show that he's been served, for instance, right?
Right.
Related, but certainly not proving. Tangentially at best. It's related only in, if it's presumed that the codes apply, right?
Which they do, we don't. So, good times.
You cannot have it both ways. You cannot require a state to prove jurisdiction and then also wish to enter a judgment plea. The only way in which you can require a state to prove up any element, including jurisdiction, is to request a trial.
So clearly she was going on about proof, and we don't, or aren't saying anything about proving anything, nor have we ever. So this is all hogwash.
And I will state for the record that the defense attorney told me that I could request a trial, or I'm sorry, not a trial, but a hearing for the prosecutor to prove jurisdiction before the trial happens. And I went to the clerk's counter to ask and request such a hearing, and they said that I needed to bring that to you.
Right.
So I'm requesting a hearing for the prosecutor to submit evidence establishing jurisdiction before the court continues to proceed in this matter.
See, there it is again, that word establishing. And they may be thinking trials establish, whereas if we just said submitting the documentation of jurisdiction. I'm not saying it wrong, I'm saying it might, again, through their bullshit minefield.
Yeah, in the sense that, I mean, it's baby steps, and we're not even getting past the first baby step. The first baby step is, have they given, just getting them to admit whether or not the prosecutor handed anything to the judge.
Mm-hmm.
They won't even go so far as that. And beyond that, if they said no, okay, do you have any? You know, beyond that, okay, do you have any reason to believe there is any? You know, beyond that, there is a, do you, are you proceeding as if you expect to get some? Is there anything that causes you to believe that some is heading your way? They're heading it off at the pass, of course. They don't want to head down that road. And they're fighting at the very first issue, at the very first baby step, which is, has he given you any? And they're like, Dad, you gotta go to a trial if you want to even hear about that topic. No, it's have you given the court any? It's the simplest of questions. It's a no. They don't want to even speak to whether or not they gave it to them in secret or overtly.
So then,
because they don't want to even head down the road.
Objection, point of clarification. Is it possible for me to arrive at a trial to challenge jurisdiction without first submitting to this court's jurisdiction, yes or no? Because it's a catch-22, right? They want to hide the fact that they're forcing you to admit to jurisdiction before giving you a chance to challenge jurisdiction. Anyway.
Well, normally, the way we handle motions is to send them. We have a court rule, a local court rule.
A little court rule. Oh, you mean a statute and code? Jeez.
Is that we have the motion hearings prior to trial. Unless it's a discovery matter, as I've indicated, we felt like we didn't have discovery, we would schedule an early motion to compel discovery.
Also.
So she's saying the motions hearing is going to be right before trial, and there's supposed to be a discovery that's earlier, but you've already filed that. I don't even know where she's going with that. It just sounds nonsensical to me, like she's wandering.
I have clearly not received any factual evidence establishing jurisdiction.
If you want to file a motion to compel discovery, then you can have that period ahead of time to make sure you have all of the discovery that the state is able to turn over and the acts of prosecutor and she has turned over all the discovery at this time. I can tell you that I have personally not discovered any matter, but I can tell you that there are notes in the file that indicate class 6. D.A. Allen gave to Jess Perkins person, and on 6-7, matters re-again emailed to Mr. Estabrook, and the notes on every CBN people were given to Mr. Estabrook. So I can certainly re-photocopy all of the reports available to Mr. Estabrook, but it appears as though all the discovery has been disclosed to Mr. Estabrook.
Okay, so if all discovery had been disclosed to me, then the evidence of jurisdiction is still lacking.
And
so I will move to dismiss the case since there is no evidence of jurisdiction.
I'm going to deny that motion at this time.
On what grounds?
The court finds that I do have jurisdiction to conduct hearings in this matter.
And how is it that you're able to find that?
Really good job, Gary.
Oh, that's a great job from the sound of it. Say that and go back in.
I was just going to say, great job on getting them onto this line of questioning in the first place. Do you want me to rewind it a little bit, Gary?
Well, the last thing he said, it was important, and I missed a part of it.
Yeah, me too. Here it comes.
We have all the discovery that the state is able to turn over. We asked the prosecutor and she has turned over all the discovery at this time.
I can tell you how that I have personally not discovered any matter, but I can tell you that there are notes in the file that indicate classic six. D.A. Allen gave to the Justice person, and on 6-7, matters again emailed to Mr. Estabrook, and the notes on every CD and people were given to Mr. Estabrook. So I can certainly re-photocopy all of the reports available to Mr. Estabrook, but it appears as though all the discovery has been disclosed to Mr. Estabrook.
Okay, so
it appears as if all discovery has been. It's a cover your ass type setup statement.
Don't you love that cover your ass? That is a non-answer.
It appears, because after all, I wasn't here. I'm just going off the record. So it appears and it appears that.
And she's just
that.
Supposing, right?
Supposing.
It's like, can I get an actual answer to the damn question?
Because they're about to impose upon you. And if you just let it, not you, Gary, or Robbie, but if you just let it slide, then what the input that is given much weight is a prosecutor's supposition about a time she wasn't even present.
Yep.
She's just looking at paper. And they, as we well know, actual reality may happen, but they'll write something completely different in the record and just not even give a fuck. And if you catch it later, they'll be like, oh, that's odd. Well, too bad. It says something else here. We're going to go with that. They don't look at videos if you ask them to look at videos. They don't listen to recordings if you ask them to do that. They won't accept verbal motions if they're damaging enough right there on the spot.
I mean, here we had, you know, half of this whole hearing was about the fact that it said he'd been arraigned, and they were going with that over any statement to the contrary, anyone who was there notwithstanding. Right.
Go ahead, Robbie. What you got on this?
Yeah, nobody that was present at that supposed arraignment is present on this day at all.
Except for you.
Except for me.
You're the only actual witness to this event.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And furthermore, they're so unconcerned that they dismiss out of hand what you said occurred without any contradiction, without any objection from anywhere. They're dismissing you because they don't like the implications.
Yep.
Of what you said.
They're dismissing your motion right there to dismiss all the charges based on the ground that hasn't been submitted. Because of bias, the judge is showing the prosecutor, and the prosecutor's action is, well, this is what it says on the file. So, I think. And that's good enough to shoot down your motion that is so far standing unopposed.
Yeah, the opposition is, it seems okay.
Yeah.
Oh my God. That's the legal burden of opposition is, it seems. Not even a committed opposition.
Mm-hmm. It seems to me. And these are the words you really get, not you, Robbie, again. When I'm talking to people who are listening to this, right? But it's those little tiny words. Those could be versus would be versus should be versus will be versus shall be versus it seems versus it is. I mean, critical distinctions. You really got to have your ears on for every word to get the totality of the tag team hustle, because they are working together. All right, here we go.
Discovery has been disclosed to me, then the evidence of jurisdiction is still lacking.
And
so I will move to dismiss the case since there is no evidence of jurisdiction.
I'm going to deny that motion at this time.
On what grounds?
The court finds that I do have jurisdiction to conduct hearings in this matter.
And how is it that you're able to find that?
As I've indicated, there's been arraignment, the law has
She says there's an arraignment, disregarding that it was taken under threat, so they already have jurisdiction, so she's relying on her imposition upon you because of what's in the computer, while ignoring the relevant challenge to it,
and pointing to something called and scrambling a law. I mean, more scramble,
she
more scramble.
She actually made the fact that you've been arraigned, supposedly, right?
Mm-hmm.
A part of why she dismissed this motion.
Yep.
When that is a matter of contention at the moment.
Yep. She just
motion to strike. That is the definition of arbitrary and capricious, right?
Wow. So she's
arbitrary and capricious, meaning she was unconcerned with reality,
mm-hmm.
right? And flippant about evidence that was offered on the topic. The fact that she gave as grounds the denial for your motion, she gave as grounds the fact that you'd been arraigned, while that fact itself had been refuted by the only witness to that event in the room.
Jesus, that's money. That's right. I think she just knee-jerk instinctively went to what she considered at that moment in time the smoking red gun, because she had been working on it so hard. You've been arraigned, and therefore arraignment equals jurisdiction, so I'm not going to justify it because of actual consent of the governed. I'm going to justify it because I've already bound you to an earlier document, not anything that was existing before this proceeding even began.
And arraignment means that challenging jurisdiction is done on certain ground, on certain levels.
Yeah.
Now, supposedly, it can be challenged at any time, yada, yada, yada. But we all know that, I mean, and this kind of indicates as well, that challenge to arraignment is far weaker after they've shoved that bar of soap in your mouth.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, because they'll take whatever definition best suits their advantage in that moment and run with that definition while ignoring all others, even if they called upon those others mm-hmm. just 10 minutes ago. Because most
because
people can't
after that's discretionary.
Yeah. We.
And you know, this is sort of the same call to the Legion from Jeff Wallace at the far right. He's actually expressed an intention to accept the CPR. I don't know if he's either not understanding or choosing to not acknowledge my representation that he certainly can accept the state's plea offer, but in doing so, he cannot challenge any of the elements of the offense, which includes proving jurisdiction.
In that one sentence lies our slavery.
Right. I think there's more than one lie per word in that sentence somehow.
Good Lord. I just want to hear her repeat that just evil, evil, evilness one more time.
Any of the elements of the offense, which includes proving jurisdiction, I don't know if he's either not understanding or choosing to not acknowledge my representation that he certainly can accept the state's plea offer, but in doing so, he cannot challenge any of the elements of the offense, which includes proving jurisdiction, subject matter, or personal.
So,
if you wish to challenge any element of the offense, both subject matter or jurisdictional, you cannot state that the plea offer is not presented. There is no option C, option A.
They're not going to accept any challenge to jurisdiction no matter what, right?
Right. So, but in essence,
this is a fighting right. This is showing that it is a fighting right no matter how you're looking at it. They're acknowledging that the right to challenge exists
right.
while fighting you tooth and nail about it.
Yep.
Right? Because they're not saying there is no right to challenge. They're saying, listen, if you take a plea, you won't have the right to challenge anymore. It's like, well, shit, that they're conceding that you have the right now, but not.
Yeah, it is. It's there's nothing about a free country that is in this. I mean, it's just shocking to me. It's you have to do this our way. You cannot. It's just hiding anything, any which way that they don't even have to. I mean, and the best thing we've got coming back is motions and embarrassment. I mean, I guess I'm just tripping out over the fact that not only are we hearing this, that's bad enough. But when you hear it so out in the open, where it's just, this is so criminal, and it's just not recognized acknowledged or treated as such because it's just so common in the way it's been. But to me, this is a woman trying to force you at the point of a gun to do something. And they don't even care that they don't have the actual right to be able to do it. They just do it anyway. Don't see it often. I don't see women acting this way often. It's interesting.
We offer option B is you challenge any element of the offense to include jurisdictional matters. If you choose option B, that means you have a trial. There is no option C.
Now, the bigger threat picture here, of course, is what they're really doing is saying, take these 8 hours of community service and bend to us, or you're going to get a much stiffer penalty if you take this to a trial. So you can challenge jurisdiction. You're going to have to admit jurisdiction by entering a plea in order to do that. Then you challenge jurisdiction. That's going to be denied. The jury's going to look poorly on you. And you're going to be found guilty and end up, we've listed the maximum penalties. They're way different than 8 hours of community service. So in essence, what's happening here is they are threatening you with take our 8 hours or take the much more scary and severe punishment, but you can't challenge jurisdiction and take the 8 hours. You cannot. If you dare to challenge jurisdiction, fuck the actual charge of what you did wrong. We're going to penalize you with the penalty that will come from a jury or a judge in a trial just for the challenge of the jurisdiction. We don't really care about the actual charge with TSA. The choices that he has are pretty much that. You can't challenge jurisdiction, not without risking that massive extra penalty that they talked about. So
even with, I mean, they're making clear that they're going to fight you. It's a fighting right, and one that they won't let you actually challenge, get done. You know, right, wrong, or indifferent. They,
sure.
You know, justice be damned. You're not going to challenge jurisdiction.
And even if Robbie was the type of person who was foolish enough to be like, oh, okay, goes to trial. Oh, great, we're at trial. All right, now I want to challenge jurisdiction. Whoever that judge is just going to steamroll the whole fucking thing there, too. Probably with something like, oh, this should have been brought up in a motion before trial. Sorry.
They know juries don't give a shit about proof of jurisdiction.
Yeah, that doesn't surprise me at all.
Jurors are like driver's license and president's card holders.
Yeah.
They're not anarchists. They're not voluntarists, you know?
It seems to me.
Like I said, yeah, you happen to get a few jurors together. I mean, with as many trials as there are in the country, you get some alignment of the stars.
Sure.
And you get some jury nullification by that Hail Mary pass, right?
Sure, sure.
But they know that they have 99% of juries have no inkling or care about jurisdictional questions.
Well, I think actually would dislike them if you brought them up. I think it might be damaging to actually bring it up because a statist who hears someone like us saying jurisdiction is a statist hearing someone like this wanting to be an exception to the rule or special or above everybody else and all the penalties they've ever had to deal with for decades of their life. Now I want to be special, and they just aren't going to be down with that.
No. They'll punish you extra for it.
Yeah, you're never going to convince them, like, oh, all these statutes and codes, you haven't had to abide by those all along. They don't have consent of the government. See, the military has a signature. We don't. The end. They're just not going to buy it.
No.
Anyway, I guess I'm just pointing out the bigger threat. It's the 8 hours of community service versus the year in jail that to me is at the heart of this issue that they just aren't, you know, saying, because that's too actual reality for them.
Yeah, they're extorting me. They're committing the crime of extortion.
But and it's that whole a handful of dirt versus war, right? If we're gonna do an analogy of the olden days, but I mean, damage control would dictate that you come back to them and say, listen, I will do 4 hours community service or something and see how that flies. but maybe after some real damning motions, you know?
If you start getting Jewish about the 8 hours of community service, I'm going to die laughing.
Right. Well, but what is it? Sincerely, what is your goal here? Damage control.
Yeah.
You're going to be spending more than 8 hours in lawyer service during this thing. You're already further than that into it, right?
Oh yeah, many times over.
8 hours feeding homeless or whatever it is, versus 8 hours of